Lesson 64, A Time of Questioning. In our last lesson, we considered the Day of Reckoning, and today we shall consider a time of questioning. Jesus is confronted by the chief priests and scribes with several questions in an effort to trap him in his words. We shall see how Jesus did not fall into their trap, but ensnares them in their own hypocrisy. After Jesus had overturned tables in the temple and chased out the money changers, the chief priests and scribes confront him about his authority and where he got his authority. Jesus realized immediately their evil intentions to condemn him. If he said his authority was from God, they would feel he was blaspheming and arrest him. But if he denied that his authority was from God, they would have reason to arrest him as a troublemaker. Jesus, realizing their trap, turned the tables on them and asked them to answer a question about the ministry of John the Baptist, whether it had been from God's authority or not. For all the people counted John as a prophet. Jesus understood that these men did not live by honesty, but by popular opinion, so he trapped them in their own game of deceitful cunning. They could not answer him without condemning themselves, so they refused to answer, and so Jesus refused to answer their question. Jesus then speaks another parable for everyone to hear. He spoke of a vineyard owner that leased out his vineyard to others, and when the harvest time came, he sent his servants to collect his share of the fruit. The vine dressers abused the servants and sent them away empty-handed. The owner of the vineyard sent his beloved son, thinking that these men would respect him. But instead, they said in their hearts that he was the heir, so they decided to kill him that they might keep the vineyard for themselves. The parable ends with the owner killing those wicked men and giving the vineyard to others. This parable really aggravated the scribes and priests because they knew Jesus was making reference to them as the evil men who murdered the son to greedily gain the inheritance. The picture is of these religious leaders of Israel holding on to their authority and position no matter what the cost. In their pride, they were blind to the fact that what they so vehemently tried to protect was not God's authority, but their own selfish ambitions. This is a great danger for anyone holding religious titles and position. Jesus finishes this parable by saying that the rejected stone has become the chief cornerstone, a quotation from Psalm 118, verse 22. By this he meant that he was the rejected stone for building God's habitation, but the rejected stone will become the chief cornerstone. In other words, the one they were rejecting was God's chosen one upon which the whole foundation of God's redemptive plan would be built. To reject Jesus is therefore to reject God's great plan of salvation and to be condemned eternally. The angry chief priests and scribes sent spies to catch Jesus in his words, and some asked Jesus a question about paying taxes to Caesar. Again, Jesus perceives their evil intent to trap him and asks them directly why they are trying to trap him. Jesus then answers the question very wisely by telling everyone to render to Caesar the things that belong to Caesar, and to God the things that are God's. Everyone was amazed at his answer and kept silent. The Sadducees must have thought of themselves as quite clever because they also brought their tough question to Jesus. They gave a scenario about a man who died without children, and his younger brother marries his wife to raise up children for his dead brother. However, the younger brother also dies without children, and this also is the case with five more brothers who all had the same woman as wife, but none had any children by her. Then they ask, whose wife will she be in the resurrection? They did not believe in the resurrection, and so the question seems self-defeating. But Jesus, nonetheless, entertains the question and provides an answer with lots of insight to help us understand some things that had not been revealed before. He says to them that in heaven the righteous will be like the angels and will not marry. Heaven will not be the same as life in this world, but will be different. Jesus also explains that resurrection is a doctrine clearly seen in Scripture for those who have eyes to see and faith to accept. He spoke about God's identifying himself to Moses as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and thus by inference the God of the living and not the dead, since these men had left the world long before God said these words to Moses. When we read our Bibles carefully to discern the meaning of what God is saying, He will grant us a good understanding when our hearts are seeking His truth. After Jesus silenced the Sadducees with His answer, no one dared to ask Him any more questions. He clearly was no match for even the wisest scholars of Israel. Jesus wants to further teach these wicked men about the limits of their own understanding so they will humble themselves and accept God's Messiah. He asked them a question about King David calling his own son Lord, and why David might do this, but they had no answer for him. If they had taken time to consider and think carefully about this question, it might lead them to understand that the Messiah was not only the physical descendant of David, his son, but he was also God's son, the Lord God Almighty. At this, Jesus warns his disciples about the hypocrisy of the scribes and priests who wear long robes, love greetings, good seats at feasts and religious gatherings, and making long prayers, but take advantage of poor widows. We should also be on our guard when we see this type of religious pride and hypocrisy, and recognize them as wolves in sheep's clothing. The stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Luke chapter 20, verse 17.